Chuck, rejoicing with one of her daughters as well. Seated her, but thank you for your prayers. Special lady, and a lot in my life. Thankful for her life. Thank you for your prayers as well. Family, praying for family is an important thing. And so let's begin with a word of prayer as we start our worship service this morning. Father God, thank you so much for the privilege of worship, for the privilege of life entrusted to our care. Lord, let us live our lives fully now as we enter your presence and we worship and adore you and celebrate who you are. Lord, may we truly experience you in a powerful way. May your presence touch our hearts this morning as we come into your presence. Lord, this is all about you. You are the focus of. So draw us into that presence. Draw us into an understanding of you this morning in a special way. I pray, Lord, that as we have gathered, that you would just continue to shape our hearts toward you. All that you have in store. Bless us, Lord. Mike?
You stand, please, with me and take time this morning to turn to those around you, greet each other in the name of the Lord this morning. Coming to his presence with thanksgiving in your heart and give him praise, and give him praise. Come to his presence with thanksgiving in your heart, your voices raise, your voices raise. Give glory and honor and power unto him, Jesus, the name of God. Thank you.
heights of the heaven.
Revelation chapter 5 says, in a loud voice they sang, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength, honor, glory, and praise." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea, all that is in them, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, praise and honor and glory and power forever. Four living creatures said, "Amen." Elders fell down. Same attitude of worship, praise is worthy.
Thank you for the prize you paid. join me as we pray? Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come into your house today. Pray that the tithes and offerings received today will help to further your kingdom as we're ready to celebrate the 175th anniversary of the church. We pray that you'll continue to bless each and every one of our lives. In God's name we pray.
Song is called This I Believe, called the Creed. If you ever wondered what we believe as a church, confused about that message, after this song, I don't think anymore.
Thank you.
Couldn't have said it better, choir. Excellent job. Do want to take a moment and draw your attention to the picture that you've been seeing this morning behind the words. In case you weren't aware of what that was, that is a, it started out as a little two-bedroom, or a two-room, not bedroom. It started out as a two-room little log cabin. It sat on the corner where the chapel now sits. And it was one of the homes that was used for Bible study, for meetings, that began the work of First Baptist Church, Richmond, Missouri, back in 1880. That house is still standing. Evidently, when we built our chapel, the house was moved. Norma took me last week out, showed me over toward the museum where it is, sitting on a corner over there. Doesn't look a lot like that. Kind of been redone. The door isn't in the middle anymore. It's over to a side, and I would imagine a lot of things have changed on that. It's probably no longer just two rooms. And actually, when it was moved, it probably wasn't two rooms, because when the church was, at one point, they took out the wall so it could worship. I have been spending probably too much, because I'm a historian type of person, time looking at the history of our church, learning a lot about who we have been and how we've gotten to where we are today. Read through a lot of business meeting notes. You wouldn't believe the business meeting notes that we keep. Burley, don't know that your WMU takes full notes of absolutely everything that happens in every one of your meetings, but they used to. It started out as the women's sewing group for First Baptist Church. That's what our women's missions started as. Sew aprons and sell them. Raise money for missions and raise money. So we're going to be sharing with you over the next few weeks different pictures of our heritage up there. So this morning, that is picture number one, where we started off, church family. Well, this morning, as we continue our series on journeys of faith, God takes us to a lesson that we are encouraged to heed. In this lesson, we will find the need to follow through by faith in what God has called us to. We'll recognize, or at least we'll come to recognize, hopefully, the consequences of our actions will be the revelation of who we are and what we have done. On Wednesday nights, we've been studying the book of Esther, and there was one part of Esther's story that we studied a couple weeks ago that sets the stage for what we're looking at this morning. See, when the edict for the eradication of all Jews was made known to Esther and to Mordecai, Mordecai had requested that Esther go before the king to seek his favor. But Mordecai also stated this: "For if you remain silent at this time, belief and deliverance will arise for the Jews from another place." Now, I want you to think about that this morning, because I believe that is exactly what happens in our account of what we're looking at. If you'll open your Bibles to Genesis chapter 11. Genesis chapter 11, our story begins in Ur of the Chaldeans, where the descendants of Shem, son of Noah, were living. We pick up the story in verse 31. Genesis 11, verse 31, if you will follow along as I read. Terah took Abram, his son, and Lot, the son of Haran, his grandson, and Sarai, his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife. And they went out together from Ur of the Chaldeans in order to enter the land of Canaan. And they went as far as Haran, and settled there. The days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Go forth from your country, and from your relatives, and from your father's house, to the land which I will show you. And I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you, and make your name great. And so you shall be a blessing, and I will bless those who bless you, and the ones who curse you, I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth bless." So Abram went forth as the Lord had spoken to him, and Lot went with him. Now Abram was 75 years old, parted from Haran. Would you pray with me? Father God, thank you for your word. Thank you for its instruction, its encouragement, its correction, and its reproof. That every time we engage, we receive. So let us engage your word this morning. You have prepared our hearts and our minds to hear from you as we have lifted our voice in praise to you. You've prepared us for what you want to say now. That our hearts might be softened, prepared to read your word. May it be so in each. Now, you know him better as Abraham. But I want to start here with that statement from Esther and looking at this story. And the first thing I want us to talk about is not everyone chooses to fulfill the call on their lives. Not everyone chooses to fulfill the call on their lives. It says, Terah took his family and set out in order to go to the and enter the land of Canaan. Now, we have a bit of an advantage here as we look at this passage of Scripture in that we know how the story goes in future times. God takes Abraham to the land of Canaan, though he does not tell Abraham where he's going in the beginning. Do you suppose it was just coincidence that Terah had set out to take his family to Canaan, when that's where God ended up taking Abraham to? I don't believe in coincidence. I don't think anything happens by coincidence. I think God has plans for every single one of us. He has intentions that are fulfilled in our lives. It isn't by coincidence. I think we have an illustration here that shows us that if one will not fulfill the call of God that God issues in their life, then he will raise up another to do it, just as Mordecai had told Esther. And I think that's what happens with Terah. I'm not criticizing Terah. Please hear me. I'm not saying that he was a bad individual. But let's be clear. Terah failed. He set out with his family. He left his country and left his people and set out with his immediate family, with the intent of entering Canaan. Now, we don't have any conversation here of God speaking to Terah. We don't have an account of that, that God had called Terah to leave. But Terah failed in what he was doing. He settled. I want you, if you write nothing else down, write this down. He settled. Now, we use that word in a variety of ways. Come and settle in. But what does that mean? See, as a Christian, I can settle in to my rest in God. That's a good thing. I can settle into this lifestyle that God has called me to. That's a good thing. But Terah took his family and they got to Haran, settled there. It means stopped. It means he quit his forward momentum. We've got several seniors in the room here this morning in high school. You're in your final semester of your initial education. Now, many of you are planning on going on to college, and I encourage you to pursue that and determine what God has called you to do. But one of the things that can so easily happen in a senior year like this is you've entered the second semester and you see the end of the road and you just settle because you know you got it made. Dangerous thing. You know, inevitably, I visit with Mr. Parker and Mr. Dunham toward the end of the year, especially as I work with our baccalaureate service. And I'm constantly in there talking with them, getting the names so we can send out invitations to the baccalaureate. And it never fails that come the end of April, still removing names from the list, kids who are going to come to graduation because they settled, didn't fulfill the last of the requirements. Christians, we are not people who are to settle like that. Terah didn't make it to Canaan because he settled in. He determined Haran was good enough. Now think about that. What do we strive for? What do you strive for in your life? You want what is good? Well, absolutely. Compared to what is bad, I want what is good. But now let's take it and change it a little bit. Which do you want? Do you want what is good or do you want what is better? Oh, I'll settle for what. That's okay, isn't it? Isn't what's good okay? Is that what you want? A lot of times that's what we do. Rather than pursuing for what is better, we settle for what is good. And even in that, sometimes we settle for what is better as opposed to what is best. Now, I'm not saying we need to be perfect in any way, but God has a plan for you. God has a plan for us. And too often we have allowed each other to settle in to where we're at and settle for what is good rather than striving for what is best. Does it mean we get what is best every time? No. But we don't start. Seniors, finish well. Christians, finish well. You know, we have experienced some loss over the past week. Several individuals who were very close relatives or members of this church finished their life out in. And many of them, they lived their life well, but their life came to an end. How do you... It doesn't matter whether you're 8 or 80 today. How do you want to finish? Determine that now. What are you going to settle for? Terah settled in Haran. But I want you to listen to this call that is issued to Abraham to finish this thought, because some people, I have, even in seminary, we talked about this a little bit. Did Terah have a call from God to go to Canaan? Well, we don't have any absolute proof of that. But I want you to listen to this call to Abraham. I believe it was a repeat of an earlier call that we do not have an account of. Look at chapter 12, verse 1, beginning with verse 1. We're going to read those three verses one more time. It says, "Now the Lord said to Abram," listen to the call here, "go forth from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land which I will show you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, and so you shall be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth will be blessed." I want you to consider and note that Abraham was not in the land of his relatives, that he needed to leave them. They had already done that. He was in Haran, where his dad and his nephew and his wife had come and settled. It says, leave your relatives. When Abraham left Haran, he didn't leave anybody there. He took all the relatives he had with him. I believe he was fulfilling a call that was probably originally issued to his father, who didn't fulfill the call. Abraham did. It was now Abraham's call, the same call given to his father, the same place with the same instructions. The second thing I want you to recognize from this passage of Scripture is this. By faith, Abraham went as the Lord had spoken to him. By faith, Abraham went as the Lord had spoken to him. In fact, Hebrews 11:8 tells us, by faith, Abraham, when he was called, obeyed by going out to a place which he was to receive for an inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he was going. It says in that he was to receive this as an inheritance. He still will receive that as an inheritance. However, this won't be an inheritance from his father. This will be an inheritance from God. I believe the initial plan that God had with Abraham was that his father would take him to Canaan and he would receive that as an inheritance. Now he receives it from God because his father didn't fulfill the call. Abraham is held up to us in Scripture as a man of great faith. And we're talking about journeys of faith. But Abraham's journey of faith is an unusual one. And it's a hard one and it is a long one. We need to remember that Abraham was a human like you and I. His faith required some testing before it became rock solid. So very quickly, the third thing I want to draw here builds on that, and I want to look at Abraham's lack of faith for just a moment. We're told how great a man of faith Abraham was, but I want you to consider for just a minute, very quickly, Abraham's lack of faith. Number one, with foreign kings. With foreign kings, Abraham's lack of faith. First, he goes down into Egypt with his wife Sarai because there's a bit of a famine going on in the land. So he goes down and leaves Canaan and goes down to Egypt. A repeat of this several years later. That is, the stage is set right here. He goes down and he looks at his wife and he says, are gorgeous. Guys, go ahead sometime today and do that. Look at your wife and say, you know she is. She'll love to hear it. But when Abraham said this to his wife, he also said, but I'm afraid. Because we're going down here and we're going into this foreign land and these kings and officials that we're going to go and see if we can get some food from and sustain ourselves, they're going to take one look at you. They're going to shoot me just so they can have you. So here's the deal. Let's just say you're my sister, which indirectly you are. So let's just go with that story. So that we're going to be okay. And if you know the story, the king sees her and, oh man, she's gorgeous. He lavishes things on Abraham and takes Sarai. Then the Lord says, young man, married. The king is like, whoa, what is going on here? He goes and has her given back to Abraham and says, please leave our country right now. Take everything you've got. Now, he had given him all kinds of livestock, all kinds of wealth for her. He just said, take it and go. Had his guards escort him to the edge of the country. Kicked him out. Interesting that a repeat of history takes place several years later. And because of a famine, sons of Israel are sent to Egypt to gather food. However, the result is a little different. And I believe because of what Abraham, children of Israel, slavery, fears, lack of faith. As if that wasn't enough, a little bit later in Abraham's life, he encounters Abimelech, a king, in the region where he's living, and he does the exact same thing. So, one of the things I want to encourage you with this morning is when you blow it in your walk with God, don't give up. I mean, hopefully you haven't gone this far where you lie about who your wife is and she ends up married. By this time, Sarah has been married to three men for all intents and purposes. Two kings and Abraham, a nomadic shepherd who lives in tents. Luckily, she was faithful and remained with him. Second area that Abraham struggled with was trying to fulfill God's promise. See, he began to be determined to fulfill God's promise himself. God had promised to make a great nation through Abraham. Well, he had brought his nephew Lot along with him. Said, well, I guess Lot will be my heir. God said, no, that is not what I told you. Sends Lot off and separates Lot from Abraham. A little bit later, Abraham says, well, I don't have any kids. I don't have anybody to pass this on to. Eleazar is my servant, my household servant, and I guess he's the one that's going to get everything if I die and when I die. So I guess he's the heir that God is talking about. And that is not who I'm talking about. Would you listen to me? And then Sarah gets in on the argument along with Abraham and trying to fulfill God's call. I mean, they're getting old. And older than any of you, okay? Still haven't had kids. So Sarah says, well, here's Hagar, my servant. That would be acceptable. You can be the father through her. That will be our. God says, just me. It was not that Abraham was trying to be disobedient to God, but that he was impatient and tried making it happen on his own. Now, church family, I ask your forgiveness because that is part of my personality as well. There are times when God says, here's where we're going, here's what we're going to do. And my personality says, let's go. I'm ready. Lord, let's do it now. Wait. On my timing, I've got this all planned out. You don't need to go through and do all of the planning of how this is going to happen. Just go with me. Henry Blackaby was right when he said, find what God is doing and be involved in that. See, the plans that God has for you as an individual, the plans that God has for us as a church, he's already got it all lined out. He's just looking for your faith to follow. And I have to watch that. I have to be careful because I have a tendency to be like Abraham. Say, let's get this going. Let's make it happen. We can find a way to do this. God. But my question, I want you to consider this, is do either of these situations fit you? Are you like Tara, who you have seen God's call on your life and you have begun pursuing that, but along the way you settled? Or are you like Abraham, where you have set out on a faith journey, but you're trying to do it on your own. You're trying to make it happen yourself rather than trusting in God. See, the last thing I want to call your attention to, it doesn't happen in this passage, but you know the story well enough. The last point is the turning point. The turning point in Abraham's life. When Abraham finally saw the fulfillment of God's promise that he would have a son and Isaac was born, Abraham had already gotten in the way enough to damage the level of faith he could pass on to his son. You know, that's one of the concerns that I have in my life as a father. Is there are a lot of things that I have learned that I want to pass on to my sons. And there are a lot of things in my life that I don't want them to pick up on. And I've got to get a handle on that. Because I'm already seeing in their lives. I'm already seeing the drive that sometimes overtakes me in my desire to make everything just right. I've seen that spill over into my son's thinking, drive for perfection in everything. None of us, we are only perfect. For Abraham, he had already gotten in the way enough that the level of faith that he could pass on to his son was going to be marred a bit. When God asked him to sacrifice his son, Abraham was faced with the choice of his lifetime. It was only on the top of that mountain, knife in hand, over his son, that Abraham reached the pinnacle of his faith walk. That is when Abraham became determined to live out the faith that God had called him to. It was then that he fully realized that God is faithful. Folks, that's what I need you to grasp this morning. The reason that your faith wanes along the way, the reason that you settle at times, the reason that you try to do it on your own is because you haven't come to the full realization, complete and total, that God is faithful. End of story. He is faithful in everything. There is nothing, absolutely nothing that he is not faithful in. That means if he has called you to something, he will fulfill it if you will simply follow and be obedient. If he has promised to bless you in certain ways, he will do it. Quit trying to make it happen yourself. You're getting in the way of what God wants to do. He also realized, this is something that I want to encourage you to read. God is. You don't need any more. There is nothing more you need. God. What am I supposed to do? Just sit at home on the couch and say, God is enough, so provide my food, provide my. Not take it out of context. God is enough for everything you need. He has a plan for your life. All you need to do is pursue that plan. Pursue that call. I would be willing to bet, as I have looked at the heritage of this church, I would be willing to bet that there are some of you sitting here this morning that at some point in time in your life, you considered the idea that God might be calling you in some form of ministry. Or mission. And you really stopped to consider that. Then you went back to life. You went back to making sure the bills were paid. You went back to making sure that you took care of everything. You went back to making sure everything was running smoothly and working. Left that call behind. Missed something. Terah never saw Canaan He never saw a land flowing with milk and honey that God wanted to bless. He never saw the reality of what God was going to settled. Let me just say this. Not too late. It's not too late for you. Whatever God desires to do, He still wants to do in life. Well, it may have changed. God's plans may have changed because of your choices. God still has plans for you. He still wants to bless you and do amazing things. Friends, what will it take for you and I to reach that point of faith that Abraham reached on the top of that mountain? A point where we completely trust that God is always faithful. Oh, we say we believe it, but do we live it? Words are cheap. To say God is always faithful and then go out and try and take care of it all yourself is a lie. That is not what He's called us to. When we say God is enough for all that we face? Is He enough for all that He has called us to? Is He enough to live our faith out completely? Or do we need to get some things worked out first? I wonder where you are this morning. It's a faith journey that you're on. Every single one of us. We need to get to the other side of the faith mountain where we quit trying to do it by our power and rely on Him. It's time to allow ourselves to have a willing heart, a heart that is stirred for the purpose of God in your life. Understand this faith journey, it's a marathon. It's not a sprint. That's one of the things that I have to remind myself. We started talking about a year ago about some needs that we have as a church family. About some needs that we have with this facility to make it more usable for the purposes of God. And please hear, this is not a criticism of anyone who has gone before me. You've talked about it before, haven't you? We have classrooms in the next two buildings over on the third floor that some of you just can't get to. We will have a time of fellowship and sharing in a meal in 3 weeks when we celebrate our 175th anniversary here. We're going to have a meal and a celebration immediately following our morning service downstairs right below me in our fellowship hall. And I know that some of you are going to have to go out those doors, possibly get in your car or walk down the hill in order to get down there. That sound like we're using ability, greatest capacity? Because here's what I know. And I know this because I have been standing at that back door on days when we're having a meal fellowship together. Table fellowship was one of the closest times of fellowship that Jesus had in the Bible. And on those days, I stand at that back door and I watch many of you go to your cars. And I know some of that is because you don't want to have to walk all the way. And you feel uncomfortable having to drive all the way. Talked about it before. Fact that we're isolated right here. You built a bathroom in the back of the sanctuary because we have nowhere else to get to one. without going downstairs or going outside. I'm not criticizing. This is a beautiful facility. And I think there is so much potential here of what God wants to do. But we started talking a year ago about the need to move forward with it. And I went out on a limb. I think I looked right at you. I'm going to give you my word. We're going to move forward with it. I know it's been dealt with. But I believe it's something that God wants to do here so that we serve Him fullness of our capacity, to the fullness of our faith. But we're going to move forward. We're going to connect these. So you don't have to go outside. Think about a young couple who comes here for the very first time with their toddler or baby. They come to the back door of the sanctuary and they say, "We're here for the first time. Do you have a nursery?" "Yes, we have a wonderful nursery with caring people." "Oh, great. Could you direct me there?" "Yeah, you go outside and you walk down the sidewalk and over to the glass doors down here in the next building. You go through those glass doors and then walk down the dark hall all the way to the other end, back of that building. And that's where you can drop your kids off. Then come on back." Young couple. Stand. When we move forward, it is not being critical of what has come behind us, what has got us to this, because what has got us to here is great things. God has done great things to this church family, but it's our turn now. It's time for you and I to live out our faith. It's time for you and I to allow God to work through us and do amazing things. It's time for us not to time for us to answer God's call. Time for you and I both to recognize that what God wants to do through your life, through my life, is amazing. It's beyond your expectation. God has plans. Ends for you. Some of us put things in. Some of you are praying about going to Guatemala with us. Don't look, listen. Tendency in situations when God calls us is we begin to evaluate. We begin to get out a piece of paper and write the pros and cons down. That's how the world deals. If you feel God calling you to do something, don't start writing the pros and cons down. Just do it. Here's what I've learned, because I'm a little bit stubborn and a little bit hard-headed. Use the word dense. I'll admit to it. But here's what I've learned. As I continue to pray and tell God, "I want to be your follower. I want to do what you have planned for me. I want what you have intended for me." If I begin to move forward in a way that I have misunderstood, you know what God will do? Hand on my shoulder, stop me. He'll put a wall up and block my way. See, God will do that. If you're pursuing Him. So, family, where is your faith journey this morning? Have you settled? It's time to get up and get. Have you been trying to do it all by yourself, taking it on yourself to do? Then it's time to get on the same page as God with the plans He has for you. Quit trying to do it. God. Looking. Eyes are running to and fro throughout the whole world, looking for the hearts of His people are willing. Is God enough for you? Is God faithful in every situation? That's the answer you pray. Father God, Lord, right now, I pray that your Spirit and your presence would move the auditorium. Every individual here, through every heart present. Lord, there are some who are here right now who have not taken that initial step of faith and asked Jesus for the forgiveness of sin, allowed him to pay the price for the penalty of sin in their life. Right now, Lord, may your Spirit move them in a powerful way to make a decision that, yes, today is the day of salvation. I want what God offers. May your Spirit also move in those of us who have come to know you as our Lord and Savior, but we've settled in. We've made life comfortable, and we're not challenged in our faith anymore. Lord, your creation has illustrated very clearly that when anything that is living stops growing, begins dying, that's not where we are. Help us fully and help us to embrace plans that you have for us as individuals. But also, Lord, I pray that you would move through this church family and you would cause us to continue to be guided together as one body, as your bride, in this community to represent you. That we would allow you help us to see your plan. Help us to recognize our time now. Lord, I'm asking our lives. Your choice. What do you do? Where is your faith journey? Does it need to be engaged for the first time? Does it need to be re-engaged? You need to let go and let God. Whatever it is, now is the time for you. What are you going to tell God? He is waiting to hear from you this morning, right now. He is waiting to hear what you are. That's what this time is all about, giving you the opportunity. The altar will be open if you'd like to come and pray. I will be here. I would love to ask questions I can, pray for you, encourage you. We'll have a couple of our deacons here as well who will sing. But as we sing, you step out, you respond to what God. Stand with me. Let's sing this hymn.
Clasp and set me free.
want to encourage you. Consider this day where you are on your faith. It doesn't matter where the person sitting next to you. It matters where you are right now. Where are you on this journey? What is it that God is wanting you to do? As we look forward to the days that are coming and what God is going to continue to do here through the ministry of this church, as His bride, as His revelation to this community and to the world, how is He going to use you? Forgive me, I don't want to offend, and I'm not intending to offend anyone, but I want you to get excited about this. You're here for a reason. God has a plan, and He has you here because He's wanting to use you. There isn't an individual in this room right now that God is not wanting to use to do even more things. That's you. You are vital in His plans. Do you recognize? Have the faith to believe it. Trust me. The journey will be exciting. Let me remind you, as Ben comes, and he'll mention this as well, but one thing I just want to say, we've got prayer meetings going on, and he's going to talk about that. But if for some reason Thursday night just will not work at all, we do have a group. Thursday night, you have to work.
On that note, as Willie was talking about with cottage prayer meetings, and he's been discussing how God can use you, these cottage prayer meetings are a great time for you to be able to know, to see what God can do through you. If you're afraid of prayer, praying out loud, we're not really asking you to go and pray out loud if you don't feel comfortable in doing so. It's a great time of prayer, but it's also a great time of fellowship. Just understand that you can't live this Christian life alone. And the cottage prayer meetings is just an opportunity for you to get to know a few people, maybe that you don't know, just talk and have a good time with each other. It's just as much as that as it is prayer. And there's two more opportunities for that this Thursday and the next Thursday, right before the 175th anniversary. So if you can, just try and be a part of that. It's a great time. Also, we have the Annie Armstrong Easter offering starting up these days. Our church goal is $3,600. As of right now, we've only received about $169. I need a little bit of context here because I was given this right before, and I don't really understand, but I was told every $50 given to Annie Armstrong Easter offering, a lamb sticker will be added to the balloon. I just need to understand that real quick because...
There's a little display of a hot air balloon back on the is put together.
Gotcha. Okay, see, I was given that. Understand exactly what it was. But also, in your bulletin, you have these prayer guides. They look like this. And in these prayer guides, you will get a daily idea of how to pray for the North American missions. And just so you know, North American Mission Board sends missionaries out constantly, and it's very imperative that we continue on praying for them and just that God will continue to move them and do things through them. So go ahead and go through that on a daily basis and just pray for the North American missions. Also, on March 22nd, there is a mission study emphasis. I would ask that you see Verlee for that because I don't know much about it, but she has all the information concerning that. Also, these invite cards that you got in your bulletin, they are for the 175th anniversary. So just go out, invite some people to it. If you are so excited to invite people, I'm sure you can get more than three. So it's just an opportunity to invite everybody around just to let them know who we are. Also, just a few meetings coming up tonight. There's a Guatemala mission trip meeting right directly after the service at 7 o'clock. If you desire to go, if you feel God calling you to go, just come tonight, try and see what it's all about, and get some information on that. Also, today, there's a Deaky meeting at 4 o'clock. Tomorrow, there's an MLT meeting at 7 o'clock. And last but not least, next week is daylight savings, and I know you really, really, really want to sleep. Get to bed at 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, whatever. Get some sleep. Come next Sunday morning. Don't be late. Just be reminded of that. And actually, there was one last thing. Chris Brown alerted me that there was an earring found in the back. And if you are missing an earring, make sure to go see the see Johnny T. Garden back there. So that's it.
John, are you going to pray for us? Come and pray us out. And of course, as we go.
Would you bow, please? Father God, we stop now, Lord, and we calm our minds and we focus on the message that we've heard today, Lord, and we long for you to lead us. And Father, I just pray that we all have the faith in our hearts to trust your leading and to follow your leading. Father, I pray that that journey begins right now as we walk out of this sanctuary today, that we hear your leading and we're faithful and we follow it, that we don't settle. That we go the distance, Father, and that we receive the benefits that you've promised to us, Lord, but that most importantly, Lord, that your kingdom is furthered here in our world. Father, we thank you for this time of worship. We thank you for the songs and for the preaching and for the fellowship that we've had. And now, Lord, as we leave, would you guide and direct us? In the name of Christ Jesus that we pray. Amen.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in Him, and be glad in Him. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in Him. This is the day.
On your way out, in addition to those cards in your bulletin, those cards are to invite community members to the Saturday.